Hey guys, today I'm going to show you how to shoot and edit this surreal double exposure portrait. So make sure you stick around. So today's photo project is super quick and easy to do. The process involves basically merging two photos together in Photoshop to create a kind of double exposure effect. So let's start by looking at the photos we need to grab. You're going to need two photos, as I've mentioned. The first is a portrait of somebody looking straight at the camera, and then the second is a photo of some hands placed side by side. To make things nice and easy for you, make sure that you shoot both photos in front of a dark background. If you don't have access to a studio backdrop, then instead you could always use a set of dark curtains or a bed sheet attached to the wall. Get creative, try and find something nice and dark and free from clutter. As for lighting, I've used my own studio flash, but if you don't have access to studio flashes, then you could always use a flash gun fired off camera, or if you have a super bright lamp knocking around at home, you could use that as well. The key really to making this whole project work is just making sure that your subject is way brighter than the background. So this means that when you actually take the photos, you're gonna have to expose for the face or the hands rather than the dark background. And that will mean that your face will be nice and bright and the background will stay nice and dark. As always, I've used my PixaPro City 600 studio flash setup, and I've also attached a small octabox with a grid on the front just to narrow the spread of light. For my portrait, I didn't do anything complicated with the lights. I just wanted one light setup positioned directly in front of Paul, who was my willing model for the day. And then I just raised up the light high enough so I could angle it down onto his face at about a 45 degree angle. Once I bagged the shot, I moved on to photographing his hands. So all I did was asked him to simply kneel down on the floor and raise his hands up above his head so that they were roughly the same height as his head was previously. When taking the photo, I just made sure that my camera was shooting his hands in exactly the same angle as I just shot his portrait, so that when it came to matching the images up later on in Photoshop, it would be nice and simple. So once you've captured both of your shots, it's time to upload everything to Lightroom. Here we just want to make some basic exposure adjustments to start off with, and also convert the image to black and white before we can take them into Photoshop and start merging them together. Obviously, your own photos will be totally different to mine, so not all of the adjustments I make here will be applicable to your own, but I'll quickly show you the basic adjustments I made so that you get a good idea of what I've done, and then you can make your own photos look similar. So starting with the portrait of Paul, I noticed that his shot was ever so slightly underexposed, so I quickly corrected that by bringing the exposure slider up to around about 0.58. After that, I reduced the saturation slider all the way down to minus 100, and this just strips out all of the color from the photo and turns it black and white. Next, I increased the contrast slider to plus 50 just to make the shot look even more moody and contrasty. I also increased the texture slider all the way up to plus 100 and the clarity slider to plus 20. Now, I often like to use the texture and clarity sliders together just to bring out a lot more of the detail in the portrait and also to add loads of contrast and make it a bit more gritty looking. Next, I just did a little bit of tinkering with the highlights and shadow sliders just to bring out some more of the shadow detail, but you may not want to do this for your own images. Finally, I located the detail tab, and then within the sharpening options, I increased the amount to 50 and the radius to 2 just to increase the overall sharpness of the photo. So I was pretty happy with the results just as a bit of a base edit. So now it was time to move over to the image of the hands. To speed things up a bit, I started off by clicking the previous button at the bottom right-hand side of the screen, and this allows me just to apply all of the adjustments I made to the previous portrait photo onto the hands photo. All I needed to do then was just move the exposure slider a little bit more to ensure that the hands were roughly the same brightness as the portrait photo. So with those tweaks made, I was ready to move over to Photoshop. So I simply saved both of the images as JPEGs by going to File and Export. So hopefully you're following along with me as I'm doing this. So you should have your two base images now. Go ahead and open those into Photoshop. So the first step we have to do is to bring both images into the same file. And to do this, you simply press Ctrl and A on the keyboard, or Command and A if you're using a Mac, and that will select the entire image. And you'll know you've done that right because you'll see the little marching ants going around the edge of the frame. Once you've done that, you just have to copy that image by pressing Ctrl and C, or Command and C if you're using a Mac, and then go over to your hands image, press Ctrl and V, or Command and V if you're using a Mac, and that will paste in the image onto a new layer. And there you have both images all in one file in Photoshop. Now, to create that double exposure effect where you can kind of see both images overlaid onto one another, you're going to need to adjust the blending mode for our top layer, which is our portrait. If you've never used blending modes before, don't worry, they're located just above the layers in the layers palette, and by default, this is set to normal. So with your portrait layer highlighted by simply clicking on it on the layers palette, you now want to click the blending mode and then go ahead and switch it to multiply. And as you can see, the two layers should now be overlaid. In my case, I felt that the portrait image was a little bit too small and didn't quite fit into the hands properly. So I decided to adjust the size of my layer by using free transform, which I quickly did by pressing Ctrl and T or Command and T on the keyboard. Once I was happy with the size and position of the portrait, I simply pressed the Enter key just to confirm. At this stage, I was pretty happy with how the image was coming along. However, I did notice that you could actually see the neckline of Paul's t-shirt at the bottom, which I felt was a bit distracting. So I wanted to remove this. So to do that, I simply went over to the layers palette, and with the portrait layer selected, I clicked Add Vector Mask. Now, you may not need to do that to your own image, but it's a good tip to know just in case you want to hide any scruffy areas or remove any mistakes. Okay, so now it's time to add a bit more detail to the eyes. Whenever I'm making adjustments in Photoshop, I always like to try and make sure that I work non-destructively. And by that, I mean that I want to make sure that whatever adjustments I make, I can undo them or change them at a later date. So in this instance, I wanted to use the Dodge and Burn tools to add contrast around the eyes. But rather than applying the changes directly to the portrait, there's a little trick I can show you to ensure that we don't make any permanent adjustments. So start by making a brand new blank layer, and then press Ctrl and A or Command A to select the entire image like we did previously. Then head up to Edit and Fill and set the contents to 50% gray before clicking OK. Finally, set the blending mode for this new layer to Overlay. So at first it may appear that we've done absolutely nothing and that layer's just disappeared, but what's actually happened is we've kind of created like an invisible layer that we can now make adjustments to using the Dodge and Burn tool without directly damaging the layers beneath it. So now, say if you make like a catastrophic mistake and you need to start over, and spamming the Ctrl Z shortcut to undo just doesn't fix it, you can simply delete this layer, make a new one, and then start over again, rather than having to start your project right from the very beginning. So making sure that the 50% gray layer we've just created is highlighted in the layers palette by giving it a click, we can now grab the Dodge tool from the toolbox. At the top of the screen, you'll probably notice there's a few options. So we need to make sure that the range is set to midtones. We also need to reduce the exposure to 10%. Now, carefully brush around the whites of the eyes and over the iris just to brighten them up a bit. If you need to, you can quickly adjust the size of your brush by simply tapping the square bracket keys on the keyboard. Once you've finished with that, switch over to the Burn tool, and we want to set the range to shadows and the exposure to 5%. Now, avoiding the lighter areas of the eyes, we just want to simply brush around the edges of the iris to darken them, and that makes a nice dark ring around the eyes to add contrast. It's also worth noting that you can use the Dodge and Burn tools to selectively lighten or darken other areas of your image too. So for my image, I wanted to darken the bottom of the hands just to make the photo a bit more balanced. So to finish off the image, we're going to add some sharpening, but rather than using the traditional sharpening methods, we're going to do something a bit more special here. And to do that, we first need to create a merged copy of all of your layers. Now, don't worry, that does sound really complicated, but actually all we need to do is press one shortcut on the keyboard. It's a bit of a handful. It's Control, Alt, Shift, and E. And that's Command, Option, Shift, and E if you're using a Mac. If you've done it correctly, you should see that there's a copy of your image at the top of the layers palette. So with that new layer created, we now need to head up to Filter, Other, and High Pass. In the box that appears, set the radius to 3 pixels and click OK. Finally, set the blending mode for this layer to Overlay. And here we have the final image. I hope you've enjoyed following along to this really simple but effective technique. If you have, please like the video and also let us know in the comments. And don't forget to share your work with us on our Facebook and Instagram pages, because we love seeing what you guys create. Anyway, that wraps things up for now, guys. Thank you very much for watching, and as always, I'll see you in the next video.